Hello and welcome to the program. The Ukrainian World Congress has stated that the snap parliamentary elections in Ukraine complied with international standards for democratic elections. Short-term observers of the UWC recorded minor violations that did not affect the voting results. And to talk more about the assessment of these elections, we're joined in the studio today by Eugene Czolij, head of the Ukrainian World Congress International Observation Mission to Ukraine's 2019 elections. Hello and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Alex.
So, first, what are the outcomes of the UWC observation mission for these elections, and what kind of minor violations did you report?
Alex, I think, first of all, let me tell you that we had 142 short-term observers that combined with the 32 from our member organization, the Ukrainian Congress Committee of America, we had in all 172 short-term observers that covered 20 oblasts in Ukraine and 23 diplomatic missions outside of Ukraine. And essentially, we recorded minor violations. For instance, some polling stations starting 5 or 7 minutes late, for the precinct commission starting its work after 7:15. We still recorded various precincts where it was difficult for elderly people or people with reduced mobility to have access. I was pleased, though, to note that in some of the schools they actually did something about it, in so that people could get by the back door through a ramp and vote. So that was something that was positive. But it was essentially issues of a minor nature. I think that as we've indicated, the governing authorities of Ukraine and the law enforcement agencies have overall been able to ensure the integrity of and the security of this electoral process. And from our perspective, the biggest shortfall of this election was the fact of Russian hybrid aggression that prevented the Ukrainian population to elect members of parliament from the occupied territories of Donbas and Crimea. From our perspective, that is the real irregularity. But unfortunately for Ukraine, it cannot control and fully decide that issue alone.
So you mean the complication for people to go through the checkpoints itself, or just the fact that they just basically couldn't
there was no vote, there were no MPs for obvious reasons that could be elected from territories that are occupied. Actually, we monitored at the end of the presidential election, in our final report, we indicated that, and that kind of shows how violent and disrespectful this aggression is, that the SMM OSCE mission, or the special monitoring mission of the OSCE, recorded, I think, over 80 ceasefire violations on the eve of the first round of the presidential elections, and about over 70 during the second round. I was informed yesterday that there was also ceasefire violations, and actually even some that have died on the eve of the parliamentary election. So it's a vicious aggression that unfortunately complicates the whole process, including the electoral process. And it's all to the credit of the Ukrainian authorities and to the Ukrainian people that had the courage to, notwithstanding this aggression, to ensure, after successful and democratic presidential elections, to ensure a successful and democratic parliamentary election.
Now, what details regarding the election process could you or would you share here?
I think that probably one aspect that we touched upon the last time that I was had the pleasure of giving you an interview was that we also had, in addition to our short-term observers, we still have our long-term observers. There are 125 long-term observers that are doing media monitoring outside of Ukraine. So in countries of residence of the Ukrainian diaspora, they have been doing monitoring since March of this year, and it's ongoing. They are covering about 30 countries outside of Ukraine in 20 languages in the world. And the we have seen and we have reported on that in our final report on the presidential election. We will be issuing an interim report on Wednesday and doing a press conference where we will show how disinformation works very clearly, whereby we're not going to be the ones saying there is Russian disinformation. We will take the same set of facts, the presidential elections and now the parliamentary elections, and give what came from Russian sources and what was being spread around the world in terms of their assessment of the same event that international recognized monitoring missions like the OSCE, ANIMO, CANADEM, NDI have done, where they have assessed these elections as being fair, democratic, transparent. And what we have seen in coming from the Russian media that goes very much in tandem with the overall strategy of showing that Ukraine is a failed state, where they were even after the first round, when the international observer missions have already given their assessment, said that this is going to be go down in history as the dirtiest election in Ukrainian history, that all of the candidates are neo-fascists, and that
that's if, a classic
narrative, and they want the I think the best one that I've seen is that Ukraine is in such chaos that independently of who wins the presidential election, that if the United States and NATO continue to support Ukraine, we will see the next thermonuclear war. So nobody stops or minces words. Disinformation is rampant, and we see that in various countries, in various languages. And I think that from our perspective, that's probably one of the most important contributions that the Ukrainian World Congress mission has accomplished with these elections.
Now, you said it yourself, these elections were free and fair. Would you say that this Russian disinformation really had an effect on Ukrainian voters, on the election itself?
I think that when you're saying the Ukrainian voter or the electorate, the decision that we had to make and be very disciplined about it is to take either the course of monitoring how the Russian disinformation affects the Ukrainian electorate, or to do media monitoring of how the Ukrainian state, the electoral process, and the candidates are being presented to the outside world. We decided on the latter on the basis of my meetings in Ukraine in February of this year, where I was informed that various other institutions and nonprofit organizations are doing the second type of monitoring. So that's why we did not really assess to what extent the Ukrainian electorate was affected.
Now, what assessment, just to come back to the mission itself, what assessment mechanism were the UWC observers using, and how do they differ from other election observation missions tool?
Essentially, our short-term observers observe online. We have devised an online questionnaire, and they are given a training before they start the observation. They essentially go to the various precincts with the questionnaire, with their smartphone, and they answer the questions as they observe a particular polling station. And once they complete, they submit the report on that statement. We then, at the end of the day, gather all of the information. And since now we have it online in that particular fashion, we're able to come up with a statement and results without necessarily having to go through the whole night doing it. How we are different, the Ukrainian World Congress election observation mission is the only observation mission that is monitoring the election in the various Ukrainian missions around the world. So for the parliamentary elections, we have monitored this process in 23 countries.
Now, we talked about long-term and short-term observers. How many long-terms, maybe roughly, how many long-terms and short-term observers did you have? And where? So you said, and you said so that the observers working were also working abroad. But roughly how many observers were?
We had 174 mm-hmm. short-term observers, mm-hmm. 142 from the Ukrainian World Congress and 32 from our member organization, the Ukrainian Congress Committee of America. And for the long-term observers doing media monitoring, we had 125 long-term observers doing monitoring in 30 countries and 20 languages.
Now, what is the requirement to be an observer in those missions?
We obviously look at their track record, see if they have any experience in that field, and usually we want to get a recommendation from at least one of our member organizations or a recognized institution, either a church or somebody that school, Ukrainian school, that can attest to the fact that that particular individual is capable of taking that kind of task upon himself or herself.
Now, you've been observing the presidential election 2019. We talked a little bit about that. Mm-hmm. How could you compare the parliamentary elections and the presidential elections in terms of quantity and volume of violations? Sorry, would you say there's a progress? Would you say how?
I would say that the biggest difference between the parliamentary and the presidential election is that the parliamentary were a snap election. So for instance, for our mission, it was substantially more difficult to get everything in order. As you know, the decree of the president was contested before the courts, mm-hmm. and the decision came literally 1 month before the election. So we essentially had 1 month where it was clearly known that the election would be held on July 21. We had a program for both long-term and short-term observers that took into account that the elections were supposed to be initially mm-hmm. in October. So we had to work very fast in order to get organized. I know that in my meetings with the various governing authorities that had to ensure the integrity of the electoral process, that they also spent quite a bit of overtime in mm-hmm. order to get things done. But the other probable difference is the fact that we had an election smack in the middle of summer, where you also had people that had already made other plans. But in terms of your precise question on irregularities, I think that we have essentially seen that both during the presidential mm-hmm. and parliamentary elections, that there were irregularities. They were minor. They did not affect the result of the vote, and they were not systemic. Mm-hmm. So that's probably at the same level in both cases.
Now we talked about authorities. Well, how would you evaluate the work of law enforcement bodies to ensure peace and security in the polling stations and in general in the process?
I think that for both the presidential and parliamentary election, especially in a context where there is a military aggression in eastern Ukraine, an illegal occupation of Crimea, constant threats, be it cyber attack threats, it doesn't just limit itself to real threats. The simple mm-hmm. fact that people worry about that and need to take necessary measures in order to be able to withstand and ensure and have the confidence both of those that are ensuring the vote and of the Ukrainian voter, the electorate, to have the confidence in the system. I think the challenge was mm-hmm. huge, and I think that the law enforcement authorities on all counts have passed the test brilliantly, and I am one of those that have already started the process in my discussions with them to encourage them to share with other countries, including Canada, that will be holding parliamentary elections in October, on how to ensure the integrity of an electoral process that is free, or as free mm-hmm. as it can be, from foreign interference.
Now, that's interesting, because usually it's the other way around. Ukraine would have, you know, have to learn from Western countries and not necessarily teach to certain countries. Like, so now how can, as you said, Canada and some other countries can learn from this, and what can these countries can learn from the Ukrainian experience?
I think that Ukraine has benefited from other countries, including Canada, in terms of technical support in order to ensure the democratic election. But I think that there is no country that can better prepare and assess and then help with the gained experience than a country that is doing this real life. It's like military exercises. You can do them as an exercise, but when you have, you're faced into a real context of a military aggression, you clearly have an acquired knowledge and experience that is on a totally different level than those that just go through military exercises. So I think Ukraine has it clearly is the victim of a hybrid aggression from the Russian side, and can share that with other countries. And that will be, from my perspective, an important contribution that Ukraine can do in its role and country that is part of that international community.
Now, the Ukrainian World Congress has been branded and, quote, undesirable organization in the decision by the Russian Prosecutor General Office, which said it posed a threat to, quote again, the constitutional framework and security of the Russian Federation. And the Russian authorities also announced this decision late in July 11, adding that the Congress would be included in the blacklist of foreign and international non-government organizations which are not welcome in Russia. What's your stance on that?
Well, it simply goes to show that an organization that has been clearly promoting Ukraine's European integration with the aim of ultimately Ukraine becoming an EU member state, that has been promoting Ukraine's Euro-Atlantic integration with ultimately Ukraine becoming a NATO member state, that has been actively promoting in order for Ukraine to obtain, for the Orthodox Church of Ukraine to obtain the Thomas of Autocephaly, that has been promoting and assisting in reforms in Ukraine, that it has been interested with such election observation missions as we've had during the presidential and parliamentary elections in order to see Ukraine become a more democratic country, that in essentially for a country to embody not just in word but in practice the European values is considered clearly by the Russian authorities as a threat to their constitutional order and security. Clearly, we have also worked with the Ukrainian authorities, with Ukrainian civil society, and with the governments of the countries of residence of the Ukrainian diaspora in order to ensure that Ukraine can ultimately ensure the stability and protect the territorial integrity and regain the occupied territories for Ukraine. I think what that also that decision is, though, superbly problematic for our community in the Russian Federation, because that the legislation in the Russian Federation provides that anybody that deals with a non-desirable organization can be the subject of penalty. Then it can be the next level is confiscation of property, and the ultimate for repeat offenses, end quote, you can actually face up to 6 years of imprisonment. So from our perspective, that branding of the Ukrainian World Congress was essentially made in order to ensure that the Ukrainian community that needs the most the contact with the rest of the Ukrainian diaspora, led by the Ukrainian World Congress, to cut it off from that contact.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Now, and to conclude this interview, I suppose this is not the last election that your organization will monitor. What, from your perspective, what kind of advice, what kind of what word of advice, yes, you would say to our Ukrainian authorities to ensure that this process can be even more democratic and more fair?
You know, it's strange because I've actually discussed with some of the missions with the successful two rounds of the presidential and now the parliamentary election. Are we nearing that day where we will not need international observers? And I think that day is nearing. However, regarding some of the recommendations we have in our final report, suggest that certain things to be done better. For instance, we have recommended that the debate between the candidates in a presidential election not be held and finish a couple of hours before the day of silence, because from our perspective, that debate should then be absorbed by the electorate. Mm-hmm. And in order for an electorate to be able to absorb it, to discuss it,
to think
mm-hmm. about it, seek the advice of experts and form an opinion, I think that would be much more logical to hold it at least a week before the election. Another recommendation that we have made is for the day of silence to be abolished. It clearly does not take into account and in no means control social media, which is superbly more influential and powerful than a billboard mm-hmm. that's there on the outskirts of Kyiv, for instance. We have asked that Ukrainian authorities ensure that all candidates are given equal treatment in the media. In the presidential election, we gave concrete recommendations in order to ensure that the legislation that's currently in place that can actually provide that if one challenges the results of the Central Election Commission, that judicial process can actually take 21 mm-hmm. days. And as you know, before the first and second round, there are 21 days. Mm-hmm. So technically, the legislation provides that process can end on the day that people are voting during the second round of the election. So we clearly then indicated that either the judicial process should be reduced or the period between the first and second round should be increased. And finally, we have also recommended that in view of the fact that there was about 13% mm-hmm. turnout in terms of voting outside of Ukraine, that it's not because of a lack of interest. We've given the example of one family that booked a flight for the whole family from British Columbia to mm-hmm. arrive to the consulate in Edmonton three times during the first round of the presidential, second, and now during the parliamentary, which clearly shows that they are interested in participating. Mm-hmm. It's certainly unreasonable to ask for a person to be booking a flight in order to be mm-hmm. able to exercise their right to vote. And we're recommending to look at things like election by mail, electronic mm-hmm. election, probably a bit early in view of this Russian aggression, or opening additional points where mm-hmm. people outside of Ukraine, Ukrainian citizens, obviously, could exercise their right to vote.
Well, thank you very much for this overview. It was a pleasure to have you in the studio to talk about these elections.
Thank you so much. It has been a pleasure to talk to you again.
That was Eugene Czolij. He's head of the Ukrainian World Congress International Observation Mission to Ukraine's 2019 election. Thank you for watching Head to Head. Stay tuned for more.